Belinda presents this unabridged recording of Jim Stynes' My Journey, written by Jim Stynes with Warwick Green, and read by Stanley McGeagh. The dedication reads, to Dad, Mam, Sharon, Brian, Terry-Ann, David and Zervla for shaping me, Sam, Matisse and Tiernan for completing me, to anyone who has been touched by cancer, may my story give you strength and hope. A note from the writer. I first met Jim Stynes when we were both 18-year-old students at the now defunct Teachers' College in Glenferrie Road, Melbourne. There must have been shared lectures along the way, but most of the memories from those days are of playing pool, table tennis matches, kicking the footy on the college lawn, organising parties, and talking about girls. We were both playing football in the VFL under-19s at the time. Jim was with Melbourne, I was with St Kilda. And one day, we lined up against each other in the ruck. We had to look away at centre bounces because we kept wanting to burst into laughter. One of my fondest memories is of travelling to Dublin and celebrating my 23rd birthday with the Stynes family before driving through the north and west of the country with Jim, his brother Brian, and friends. We became great mates. I was a groomsman at his wedding, and he was godfather to my two oldest children. When Jim was diagnosed with cancer in 2009, his family and friends were stunned, but we all felt certain that he would overcome the disease, just like he had met every other challenge in his remarkable life. Jim knew that the media would be fascinated with how he dealt with cancer and decided to make that journey very public, but on his terms. He hoped that his story might help others who had cancer, particularly those who did not have the support or the resources or the resolve that he did. Months later, on a bleak and wintry afternoon, Jim became emotional as he lay in a darkened room in Epworth Hospital and spoke about the diary notes he had been diligently keeping on his laptop. He hoped to publish the story of his journey and wanted to know if I could help him turn those notes into a book. After that, we tried to catch up once a week, sometimes discussing life and its meaning, other times just hanging out and talking sparingly because his health was poor or his memory failing. As was Jim's way, he would push and prod to make sure the book was the best it could be. To that end, Jim's family, friends, and medical team were gracious and generous in making sure the whole story emerged. I feel blessed to have spent that time with Jim. Warwick Green. Chapter 1, Finding Out. Hey, what's that? Not necessarily what you expect to hear from your wife during an affectionate hug. What is what? I replied, maybe a little more tersely than I should have. You've got this lump on your back, Sam said, just here. She prodded at a spot just next to my spine, that annoying place where you can never quite reach to scratch an itch. I didn't know what it was, and I was dismissive. It was probably just a fatty knot, scar tissue, a war wound from my football days. Since retiring, I'd had a couple of operations to remove bone spurs from my ankles. Maybe this was the backbone equivalent. Sam wasn't so easily brushed aside. Well, you should get it checked out. Yeah, I will, I said, with a total lack of conviction. Over the next few months of 2008, the lump wasn't mentioned again. It was not something I could see or feel, and besides, I had more important things to get on with. That June, I had taken on the busy role of president of the Melbourne Football Club, the AFL team I had played 264 games for between 1987 and 1998. My other passion was Reach, the youth organisation I had founded with a mate, Paul Curry, in 1994. I also had business interests to attend to with Pacific Early Learning Group's childcare centres, as well as property management. and somewhere in among all of that, I found time to devote to my wife, Sam, our daughter Matisse, who was 7, and son Tiernan, 3. By the end of 2008, then, I couldn't wait to leave behind the stresses of life and sit on the beach down at Rye with the kids. January 2009 was sweltering, with temperatures occasionally hitting the 40s. Matisse and Tiernan spent the evenings splashing about in the shallows of Port Phillip Bay while I looked on, usually trying to avoid the temptation of checking my mobile phone messages. On one of those evenings, our friends and business partners, Hugh and Catherine Ellis, were there with their 2 daughters. Life was good. I stripped off my T-shirt and reached for a towel. "Is it just me, or can you guys see that thing on his back?" Sam asked. Our friends agreed. "Yeah, there is something. You should really get that looked at, Jim." So when a few weeks later, I found myself standing next to one of Melbourne's club doctors, Carl Fried, while the footballers were training, the words, "You should really get that looked at," popped into my head. Carl examined my back and was concerned enough to write a referral for me to see a specialist. I slipped the referral into my diary and added it to my mental checklist. It remained there for weeks. Eventually, I thought I might have lost it. More weeks passed. One morning in May, I was walking back to my car after a meeting in the leafy Melbourne suburb of Malvern. My stomach was rumbling, and since I wasn't rushing to another appointment, the idea of a sandwich appealed. While wandering up Wattletree Road, I realized that I was in front of the rooms of Graham Southwick. A keen follower of the Melbourne Footy Club, Graham is a plastic and reconstructive surgeon. Many in the wider public will remember his work after the Bali bombings in 2002, which killed 202 people, 88 of whom were Australian. Graham was in Indonesia at the time on a 3-day break after a medical conference. Amid the chaos at Sangla Hospital in the 48 hours after the bombs went off, he worked tirelessly, treating dozens of burns and blast victims. I had come to know Graham during my playing days. For him, sitting in the members' stand at the MCG on a Saturday afternoon was something of an escape. But whenever one of his beloved demons was forced off the field with a gash or a bloodied head, he could be relied on to duck down into the rooms and quickly stitch us up, always with the most delicate threadwork. Graham once told me how he'd missed most of the 2000 AFL Grand Final in which Melbourne faced Essendon. He had rushed to the rooms in the first quarter to assist our teenage forward, Brad Green, who had taken a nasty knock to the throat, only to find himself flanked by a concussed Troy Simmons, who had been knocked senseless by a hit from Essendon's Michael Long. It had been an ugly bump. That reminded me, the lump. Maybe Graham could examine it. I rifled through my diary, looking in vain for the referral, before deciding that I should pop inside and ask anyway. At reception, while it was patiently explained to me that Graham's every moment over the next few days was crammed with appointments, the man himself appeared through a doorway, following one of his patients. "Big Jimmy," he said, "what brings you here? When are we going to get the demons off the bottom of the ladder and winning again?" I explained why I had come, and after quickly checking his schedule, Graham flashed a grin and mouthed a hushed plea to the exasperated receptionist. "I know, but just give me a couple of minutes," before ushering me through to his rooms. "Right, let's have a look then." As he gently poked around the region near my spine, Graham explained that the lump was elongated, almost oval-shaped. He was surprised to find out that I had ignored it for so long. I later learned that it is not unusual for such a lump to be diagnosed as a lipoma, which is a benign soft tissue tumour. Lipomata are soft to the touch and are generally painless. But Graham was not prepared to discuss any scenarios. "I'm going to give it a quick ultrasound, Jimmy." After doing so, Graham examined the results. "Hmm," he said, before escorting me back out to the front desk. He turned to the receptionist, saying, "I want to book him in for exploratory surgery." Then to me, Graham said, "It needs to be in the next few days, Jim. Make sure you clear an hour in your diary. I want to get this out in one go." denial can be a powerful defence mechanism. As a footballer, I had employed it throughout my career to overcome injuries and to conquer self-doubts. Yet still it seems extraordinary to me when I look back on it now that when I pulled up in the car at Wattletree Road a few days later, I hadn't even remotely considered that I might have cancer. Inside the rooms, Graham explained that he also wanted to remove a couple of moles from my body, one from my neck, another from my ear. To my mind, the lump on my back was just a larger, more inconvenient blemish that needed to be cut out in the same way. I lay on my stomach, waiting for the local anaesthetic to kick in, and listened to the banter between Graham and his assistants. It was a bit like being at the dentist. You need to take your mind somewhere else to make the time tick over more rapidly. After about 40 minutes, I was becoming slightly uncomfortable. Graham, I'm starting to feel what you're doing back there. I think I might need some more anaesthetic. They ramped up the pain relief and resumed. I was fine. But after a while, I began to feel the instruments again. Now I was becoming edgy. It wasn't so much that I felt pain. It was more a sense that Graham was in my body, not working on the surface. It felt like he was in deep, about as deep as you could possibly imagine a surgeon being inside your body. I remember thinking at one point, this might be worse than I first thought. But not long after that, Graham began to stitch me up. He rested a hand on my shoulder, exhaled in a way that suggested relief, and said, right, we're all done. In that moment, my doubts disintegrated in a wave of positivity. It's always been my natural inclination to take an optimistic approach. So as I stood up and leaned across to grab my shirt, I thought, okay, it's all good. The lump was out. I barely registered being told that it would now be sent away to be tested. By that evening, I had banished the whole episode from my mind. The only reminders were the jolts of pain that occasionally flashed through my back. But my thoughts were elsewhere. There were the final details of a Reach youth camp in Sydney that weekend to organise. Furthermore, Melbourne's home game that Saturday night was being played 1,700 kilometres away. Instead of running onto the MCG, the boys would be taking on St Kilda at the Gold Coast. There was plenty to get on with. My only thought about the day's surgery was that it was going to be annoying having to answer questions about the couple of visible scars where the moles had been removed. Of course, Sam had wanted to know how the exploratory surgery had gone and was keen to have a look at my back. Despite the unwieldy dressing on the wound, I assured her that the surgery had done its job. It had just taken longer than expected. I did tell Sam about the nervous moment I'd experienced. They were all chatting away and happy, I said, but at one point they went quiet. It just felt like the mood in the room changed. But I was convinced that all would be fine now. A few days later, Graham phoned me. Can we get you in here? How about Monday? I found an empty space in my diary. No problem, I said. But why the appointment? It's a follow-up, Graham replied. We can discuss it on Monday, Jim. Oh, and ask Sam to come along too. He hung up. I stopped and frowned, biting my lip. That last sentence hung in the air, making me a little apprehensive. My mind began to wind over. There was a conversation going on inside my head between positivity and negativity. Maybe that lump could be cancer. But even if it is, it must be a one-off, and it's been removed now. So why does Sam need to be there to hear that? It could be some test they want to do. Maybe they need her to drive me home. There would be no answers until Monday. Sitting in the waiting room, I still didn't get it. Sam and I had been ushered to a small private anteroom. At one point, Graham's top half appeared around the doorframe, apologizing for keeping us waiting. Bear with me. I'll just be a moment. While I began to grumble about medical types never being on time, Sam had picked up in an instant that the usually jovial doctor had seemed uncommonly tense. He looks worried, she said. Graham reappeared soon afterwards and shepherded us into two comfortable chairs in his office. He did not mess around with niceties, but he did seem to be choosing his words very carefully. "I'm going to explain the situation," he began. "But Jim, what I'm about to tell you might not sink in very well. Your mind might go someplace else. Sam, you will need to listen carefully. The results of the biopsy are back. The lump that we removed was a malignant tumour. It is cancer, but at this time we are not sure which type. We've had several specialists examine it, but it is unclear what we're dealing with." As Graham had warned, I heard the word cancer and not a lot more. I experienced an intense rush.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.